Welcome to Adult Sleep Stories. Finding moments of peace in the hustle and bustle of our lives can be a big challenge. Our channel is your sanctuary, a place where captivating tales blend with soothing tones, guiding you toward restful slumber. Escape from the noise, let go of the day's stresses, and allow our stories to transport you to realms of tranquility and dreams. Whether you're seeking relaxation, meditation, or simply a good night's sleep, you're in the right place. So, settle in, close your eyes, and let the journey to serenity begin. In our unceasing journey through the corridors of life, moments of pure, unadulterated tranquility can sometimes seem as elusive as shadows at noon. The modern world is a symphony of endless noises, from the incessant hum of digital screens to the ceaseless whispers of obligations, commitments, and desires. In this symphony, our souls often search for a gentle lullaby, a melodious escape, a chance to pause, breathe, and simply be. Now, as you find yourself here in the magic of this narrative oasis, know that you've stumbled upon a sanctuary, a world where serenity isn't just a luxury but a promise. Picture, if you will, a secluded haven nestled amidst nature's embrace, where the wind hums lullabies and time itself seems to tread lightly. This is where we invite you to journey with us, a place of meditation, reflection, and utter calm. Begin by taking a deep, resolute breath. Feel the cool air grace your nostrils, traveling through the depths of your lungs, filling your being with the ancient rhythms of existence. And then, as you exhale, imagine releasing the shackles of worry, stress, and the relentless march of time. Each subsequent breath is a step deeper into the heart of tranquility, a dance with the universe, an affirmation of the present moment. We live in an era where the very essence of our existence often feels fragmented. Pulled in myriad directions by demands, expectations, and the invisible threads of technology, it's easy to lose oneself. But these tales, each a gem sculpted from the rich tapestries of imagination and insight, seek to offer you a bridge. A bridge not just to sleep, but that in itself is a cherished realm of restoration, but to a state of soulful relaxation, where the world narrows down to the here and now, where every heartbeat is a reminder of life's simple beauties. These stories are not just words. They are portals. They beckon you into worlds where the pace is gentler, the colors more vivid, and the sounds harmoniously aligned with the rhythms of the cosmos. Here, amidst these tales, you'll find characters and landscapes that resonate with the deepest parts of your psyche, invoking a sense of familiarity and nostalgia. They're like old friends or forgotten dreams, waiting to welcome you back. As you immerse yourself in these narratives, let the outside world fade into soft focus. Envision your stresses and anxieties as leaves carried away by a gentle stream, disappearing beyond the horizon. Let the weight of expectation, the clamor of responsibilities, and the noise of uncertainty be replaced by the soothing cadences of these stories. Every word, every phrase, is a brushstroke painting a world of peace, inviting you to step in and explore. Sleep, that precious gift, is not just a physical necessity but a balm for the soul. It's nature's way of healing, restoring, and rejuvenating. As you stand at the threshold of dreams, these tales are the gentle hands guiding you towards restful slumber. They remind you of the beauty of surrender, of letting go, of drifting into the comforting embrace of night. So, dear listener, as you embark on this journey with us, know that you are not alone. Through the magic of these tales, we are with you, sharing in your quest for tranquility and deep, restorative sleep. Let these stories be your anchor, your lighthouse, guiding you away from the tempests of daily life and into the calm waters of relaxation and dreams. Welcome to our sanctuary. Let the journey to serenity begin. A gondola trip on the canals of Venice. Chapter 1. A Whisper of History. As I stepped into the sleek, black gondola, the water of the Venetian canal gently lapped against the side of the boat. It was a sound as old as time in this city, a soft murmur that spoke of the ages, of secrets nestled in the water's depths, and of tales waiting to be told. The gondolier's greeting was a nod to tradition, his smile revealing a lineage that could trace the ebb and flow of Venice's fortunes as easily as he navigated its waterways. With an elegant motion that only years of practice could perfect, we slid away from the bank, embarking on a journey not just across the water, but back through time. To my left and right, the city rose, splendid, surreal, and serenely silent. The buildings, a cascade of weathered pastels, seemed to emerge from the water itself, their histories etched into the intricate stonework and delicate frescoes that adorned their facades. Each one carried the weight of its own story, some of whispered scandals behind velvet curtains, others of grand celebrations that echoed with the laughter of centuries past. The lull of the boat through the placid canal seemed in harmony with the gentle sway of the city. Here, the Venetian pulse was more than just the thrum of life from within, it was an energy that resonated in the very lap of the waves against the crumbling brickwork. This was a place where the boundary between the present and the past grew thin, where the water carried reflections not just of the sky and stones, but of all the lives that had touched its surface. The gondoliers were cut through the canal with a practiced grace, propelling us into the open arms of the city. His voice began to weave stories as our boat wove its path, stories of opulent merchant ships returning with silks and spices, of clandestine meetings and masked balls where every face wore a secret, of artists whose hands brought to life the Renaissance that still colored the city's character. His cadence matched the ripple of the water. It was as though he was dipping his words into the canal, letting the city draw forth its history in a tapestry of narrative and song. As the vessel meandered, the sun's touch grew gentle, its rays turning from the harsh white of midday to a warm, golden embrace. Shadows lengthened, stretching themselves like cats across the pathways and up the walls, lazily reclining as the day began to wane. The murmur of water was now accompanied by distant voices, the clink of glasses, and the faint, yet ever-present scent of salt marshes mingling with the aroma of freshly ground coffee from a nearby cafe. Here, on the water, one could drift through the lives of others, an invisible thread connecting moments and memories. Faces peered out from balconies, hands rested on ancient balustrades, and eyes followed the gondola's journey with casual curiosity. To them, I was but another passing traveler in the endless flow of Venice's guests, seeking the embrace of her storied embrace. We passed beneath the Bridge of Sighs, a portal to a bygone era created by its stone arch. As he related the story of how captives were said to have sighed at their last glimpse of picturesque Venice through the bridge's windows before being brought down to their cells, the gondolier's voice got softer and more solemn. But today, the sighs had long since vanished into thin air, leaving only the beauty that had inspired them, framing a picture-perfect sky. The canal opened up to reveal a vista of the city, a grand sweep of architecture and life. I caught glimpses of private courtyards, secret gardens tucked away behind imposing palazzi, their existence hinted at by the high walls and the verdant overflow of plants and flowers that crested them. In one such hidden enclave, a fig tree spread its boughs, heavy with fruit, a silent testimony to the private joys and sorrows it had witnessed within its secluded domain. My gaze lingered on the vibrant tapestries that hung from the windows, the aged linen dancing in the breeze. They were adorned with intricate patterns and colors that spoke of lands far away, of the Silk Road and its caravans, and of a time when Venice was the jewel in the crown of commerce and culture. There was something deeply soothing about their movement, a visual lullaby set against the symphony of water and stone. As we rounded a gentle curve, the cityscape shifted, the density of buildings giving way to an open expanse where the Grand Canal met the setting sun. The light here was a painter's dream, a spectrum of hues that no palette could fully capture. The water reflected the ballet of colors with such clarity that it was as if we floated through the sky itself. Venetians of all walks of life congregated here, a confluence of paths and purposes, each person a solitary note within the city's grand melody. To my right, a cluster of children laughed as they dangled their feet over the edge of the pier, their innocent delight a stark contrast to the ancient wisdom of the stones beneath them. Their voices, high and clear, rang out across the water, skipping over the waves like pebbles. They were the future of Venice, these bearers of unrestrained joy and simple pleasures, weaving their own threads into the fabric of the city's legacy. As the daylight began to relinquish its hold, the gondola slipped through the quieter back canals, the bustle of the Grand Canal fading into a distant hum. Here was the Venice of the Venetians, laundry strung between windows, the aroma of dinner wafting out from homes, and the gentle chiding of a nana calling her grandchildren inside. It was a slice of everyday magic, a reminder that even in a city as steeped in grandeur as Venice, the simple acts of daily life were woven into its splendor. The journey continued, the gondola a steady constant in the ever-shifting dance of light and water. And as night began to drape its velvet across the horizon, the city's visage transformed yet again. Lanterns flickered to life, casting a soft glow that seemed to rise from the water, beckoning the night with a warm embrace. Stars peeked through the dimming sky, shy at first, then growing bold as the daylight faded completely. A deep sense of serenity settled over me, a contentment born from the marriage of water and stone, history and life, that was Venice. This city, more than any other, knew the secret of time, that it was not a straight line but a meandering river, flowing with the tides, guided by the moon and graced by the touch of countless lives. And as I returned to where I began, stepping from the gondola onto the cobbled street, I carried with me the echo of its whisper, the breath of history that was as much a part of Venice as the water that coursed through its heart. As the gondolier bid me farewell, I knew that the memories of this day would remain etched in my mind, as vivid as the colors of the sunset that I had witnessed on the waters. Venice was not just a city, it was a living, breathing work of art, a testament to the resilience of beauty and the enduring power of stories. And as the night settled in, I turned for one last look at the canals, where the dance of light and shadow continued, timeless and eternal. Chapter 2. The Heart of the City. The tranquility of the canals was like a lullaby. Helen's gondola glided smoothly under the embracing arch of yet another ancient bridge. She could hear the distant voices of the city, a tapestry of life that Venice has worn with pride for centuries. The gondolier's song had a haunting quality, a melody that spoke of love and loss, joy and sorrow, all interwoven with the ebb and flow of the tide. A soft breeze danced across the water, carrying with it the scent of salt and the faint perfume of blooming jasmine from the hidden gardens that graced many of the waterfront palazzos. Helen closed her eyes for a moment, allowing herself to be transported by the sensations that cradled her. As the gondola emerged into the open waters of the Grand Canal, the scene transformed. The quiet intimacy of the smaller canals was replaced by the grandeur and bustle of Venice's watery main street. Majestic buildings lined the edges of the canal, their facades a celebration of the city's wealth and artistry. The setting sun cast a golden glow on their fronts, and the water below mirrored the spectacle, creating an illusion that the whole world was dipped in molten light. Helen watched as other gondolas passed by, each carrying its own stories. She saw lovers entwined, families laughing, and solitary souls lost in thought. Overhead, seagulls cried their own tales into the wind, weaving between the campaniles that reached for the heavens. The gondola passed under the Rialto Bridge, its storied stones a testament to the endurance of this place. Merchants closed their stalls for the day, their voices carrying over the water as they called final offers to the lingering tourists. The day was drawing to a close, and the first stars began to peek out from the indigo sky. Lanterns flickered to life along the canal, their reflections a constellation in the water's surface. Helen felt the day's impressions settle in her heart, the beauty and the serenity of it all. It was a deep calm that she knew would stay with her, a memory as vivid and poignant as the city itself. The gondola turned into a secluded canal, and the cacophony of the Grand Canal faded into a serene silence. Here, the water was still, and the reflection of the sky above seemed so perfect that it was as if two worlds existed in harmony, one above and one below. Helen's eyes were drawn to the intricate ironwork of the balconies above, to the fluttering laundry that waved like flags from the buildings, to the flowers that adorned every windowsill, cascading down like waterfalls of color. Every corner, every shadow held a story, and the fading light seemed to whisper secrets of centuries past. The gondolier's voice began to wane as he steered the gondola toward a small pier. "Signorina, we arrive," he said, his voice mingling with the gentle lapping of the water against the stone. As she stepped off the gondola, Helen felt as if she was leaving a part of herself behind and trusting it to the gentle care of Venice's canals. The night was now in full command, and the city glowed with an ethereal beauty. She took one last glance at the gondola as it floated away, the gondolier's silhouette part of the canvas that was Venice at night. Helen tucked the memory close, a story etched upon her soul, a moment in time that was hers alone. This was Venice, the city of mirrors, the city of mirages, at once solid and liquid, air and stone. Helen knew she would carry this journey with her, a serene voyage on the tranquil waters that were the lifeblood of this unique city. Chapter 3. Echoes of the Artisans. Helen stepped onto the worn cobblestones of the alley, leaving the graceful dance of the gondola behind. The night air was cool, a gentle shawl upon her shoulders. The sounds of the city at night were softer here, a distant serenade that blended with the quiet splashes of canal waters against ancient walls. She began to walk, her steps unhurried, tracing the pathways that meandered through the heart of Venice. The path wound like a labyrinth, a pattern as complex and intriguing as the history etched into the very stones she tread upon. The city seemed to be whispering to her, sharing its secrets with every turn she took. The moon had risen high, a sentinel in the sky, casting its silvery light through the narrow alleys, turning the canals into ribbons of quicksilver. Helen felt the weight of countless stories around her, each building, each shadowy corner holding centuries of laughter and tears, meanings, and farewells. She found herself in a small piazza, the kind that tourists rarely see, where the real Venice breathed and lived. A group of children were chasing each other, their laughter ringing clear in the night, a reminder that amidst the stones and water, life surged forward. Helen paused beside an ancient well, running her fingers over the weathered stone, feeling the pulse of the city. She closed her eyes and listened. From somewhere nearby, the strains of a violin caressed the night, the music a poignant reflection of the beauty that surrounded her. Continuing her nocturnal exploration, Helen ventured towards the echoes of the melody. She discovered its source in another secluded square, where a solitary violinist played for an audience of shadows and stars. The melody was familiar, Vivaldi perhaps, another son of Venice, his music a legacy that thrived in the city's soul. She stood there, transfixed, as the music enveloped her. It was as though the composer had distilled a piece of Venice into the notes, and now they were alive again, dancing through the air. The violinist's bow caressed the strings, and the notes soared up to the balconies above, a serenade to the sleeping city. Helen felt as if the music was a bridge across time, connecting her to all those who had stood in this place before her, all those who had loved and dreamed in this city of water and light. When the music ended, the silence seemed full and deep. The violinist, with a knowing smile, nodded to her before packing away his instrument, leaving the square to its dreams. Helen took a deep breath, the night air tasting of salt and mystery. She wandered for hours, her heart open, her mind alive with the stories of Venice. She watched as night gave way to the first blush of dawn, the sky turning from black to a deep blue, the stars fading one by one. Finally, she found herself on the steps of a sleeping church, its doors closed, its bell tower stretching up to the awakening sky. Here, she sat and watched as the city stirred to life, the morning light painting the world anew. Boats began to move along the canals, the voices of the gondoliers calling to each other in a lilting song. Fishermen returned with their catch, the fish silver and glistening, a bounty from the lagoon. And all the while, The sun rose, turning the sky from blue to a canvas of pink and orange. As the new day began, Ella knew that this journey would stay with her forever. Venice, with its canals and alleys, its music and stories, had become a part of her. She had traveled through not just a city, but through a living tapestry woven with the threads of human experience. And when she finally rose to return to her lodgings, the city was awake, alive with the sounds of the day. Ellen moved with the flow, a single thread in the vibrant fabric of Venice, forever changed by her journey on the serene and whispering canals. Chapter 4. Whispers of Stardust. Ellen had always felt an affinity for the silver screen, the allure of the golden age of Hollywood captured in the glossy prints of movie magazines and the grand stories of her grandmother, Lillian, who once brushed shoulders with the stars at the Trocadero on Sunset Boulevard. As Ellen sat in the cafe, a replica of those bygone times, she felt as though she had slipped through time. A tune played on the piano, the notes hanging in the air like the smoke that lazily curled from the cigarettes held in long, elegant holders. Ellen sipped her coffee, the bitter liquid grounding her in the present, yet her imagination was free to wander. The walls, adorned with framed pictures of cinema greats, seemed to whisper tales of a glamorous past, while the Art Deco chandeliers cast a soft glow, diamonds of light dancing on the polished surfaces. Her eyes were drawn to the grand piano in the corner. The pianist, a young man with a brooding expression, played as if he was alone, lost in the music, his fingers moving with a practiced ease that spoke of a lifetime dedication to his art. Ellen wondered about his story. Was he a dreamer like herself, lured by the siren song of Hollywood, seeking a break in the land of stars? As the evening progressed, the cafe began to fill with a blend of characters. There was Clara, a regular, who claimed to have been an extra in numerous films of the 30s, her bright lipstick and cloche hats a permanent fixture, her stories a blend of fact and hopeful fiction. Then there was Jack, a screenwriter who always sat at the bar, his typewriter in front of him, a constant clack of keys punctuating the music, his presence a reminder of the unglamorous grind behind the glitz. Ellen's dream was interrupted when an enigmatic man appeared out of nowhere. His suit was so well-fitting that it looked like it was from a bygone age. His hair was pulled back, and a subtle smile was on his lips. At the door, he halted and looked around the room before moving toward the bar. The stoic bartender, who'd seen plenty come and go, gave a rare nod of acknowledgement. The stranger's presence brought a subtle shift in the atmosphere. Conversations hushed, glances were exchanged, and the pianist's tune morphed into a slower, more haunting melody. Ellen watched as the man ordered a drink, his voice a smooth baritone, barely audible over the music. There was something familiar about him, a resemblance to a face she had seen in the black and white pages of her grandmother's photo albums. Drawn by curiosity and a touch of recklessness, Ellen approached the man. "Excuse me," she said, her voice steady despite the flutter in her chest. "You seem familiar. Have we met before?" The stranger turned, his eyes meeting hers, and in them, she saw a flicker of something enigmatic, a depth that suggested a thousand stories. "I believe some faces are just echoes of the past," he replied, his words cryptic yet oddly comforting. They fell into conversation, the cafe fading into a backdrop as they discuss films, the illusion of fame, and the bittersweet taste of dreams. Ellen learned his name was Vincent, a writer-turned-director who had left Hollywood at the zenith of his career, disillusioned by the industry, seeking solace in obscurity. The evening waned, and the patrons began to trickle out, leaving Helen and Vincent in a bubble of their own creation. Outside, the world continued its relentless march, but inside the cafe, time seemed to have stilled, granting them a reprieve from reality. Helen's fascination with the Golden Age had always been rooted in the past, but Vincent showed her the threads that connected it to the present, the way the old glamour had shaped the world she knew. He spoke of the power of storytelling, how it could uplift, enlighten, and, most importantly, how it could heal. As the clock neared midnight, Vincent stood up to leave, his departure as sudden as his arrival. "Hollywood may be a land of make-believe," he said, "but sometimes it's in the unreal that we find the most truth." Ellen watched him go, his silhouette eventually swallowed by the night. She sat there for a long while, the cafe empty now, save for the ghosts of yesteryear. When she finally left, the cool night air embraced her, the stars above blinking like distant camera flashes. The evening at the cafe was an interlude, a brief sojourn in a world she had long admired from afar. As she walked home, her footsteps echoed on the pavement, a steady beat that matched the newfound rhythm in her heart. She realized that the Golden Age of Hollywood wasn't just a time or place, it was a feeling, a hope, a dream that lived on within each story told. Ellen's path had crossed with Vincent's for only a brief moment, but his words left an indelible mark. Perhaps one day, she mused, she would tell a story of her own, a story that would whisk someone else away to an evening filled with whispers of stardust. And so, the night at the cafe became a chapter in Helen's life, a memory etched in golden hues, a night where the past and present danced, blurring the lines between reality and the magic of the silver screen.